Dr. Amanda with Straight Smile Solutions, straightsmilesolutions.com, and we're here to talk about Hawley retainer design, clasp selection, and lab slip writing. how to populate a lab slip. So let's talk a little bit about Hawley retainers, because sometimes I get doctors that ask me, well, what's your standard Hawley? And I say there is no standard Hawley. First of all, I'm going to be making a really great video. It's going to post next week sometime on retainer menus, and I'm actually going to create a retainer menu template, which is going to be available. It's going to be available for anyone who is a Straight Smile Solutions client, who's done an a la carte session, who's a VIP member, who's a concierge member, or a premium member. Otherwise, it's going to be available for $20. But in any case, sometimes we do promos and give stuff away. It's a lot of work to create it, but let's talk just specifically about Hawley's. Hawley's are kind of out of style. Not too many people are using them. Go through all of our pros and cons from our retainer playlist. If you want to listen to our retainer playlist, you can go to our YouTube channel, which is Straight Smile Solutions. If you go to your YouTube, put Straight Smile Solutions in the search bar, it takes you to our YouTube, which should have a green banner. If you scroll down on the homepage, you will see playlists. Retainer one is, you know, towards the bottom where it should be. It's retention. And you can see all the pros and cons of all the different types of retention for phase one, for comprehensive, for extraction cases, for non-extraction cases. You'll get the gist if you go through all those videos. But we're going to talk specifically about Hawley clasps. Now, I'm not going to talk about adjusting Hawley clasps because I have a video already on that, and it's in the retainer playlist. It's a how-to video. You'll see me using a three-prong and a bird beak. We're just going to specifically talk about five different types of Hawley designs and how to take into account for each case, if you decided they did want a Hawley for whatever reason. Like I said, it's not very popular. Now, I wear a Hawley. That's my personal preference. So I think it tends to be more either younger kids or older patients who maybe had a Hawley in the past. Like, I had a Hawley in high school, so it just felt comfortable with me. So when I had ortho retreat in my 20s, I tried an Essex. I couldn't get with it. Just felt weird, you know? Had a bonded, didn't like it. So I decided to go with the Hawley, which is what I felt comfortable with. I like that my teeth can touch down. That's kind of important to me. So different types of clasps. You've got Adams clasps, Adams. You've got ball clasps. These are kind of funny ball clasps, but usually they melt it so it turns into an actual ball. Adams, that's about it. So labial bows, they can go 3 to 3. 3 to 3, it's canine to canine, 3 to 3. These are wraparounds, we'll get to those in a minute. Or they can go 2 to 2. You can see here, there are some guide wires that are going distal to the ones. This would be something you'd wanna do if you wanna ensure that a gap stays as closed. You could run guide wires over 1 to 1. Lots of things you can do. If you have a 3 to 3 or a two to two bow would be for a phase one case. Because you would not want to do a 3 to 3 because usually the threes aren't erupted or they're out to fall out and you might block your threes eruptions. But usually a 2 to 2 works pretty well. You still got to keep your eye on the three eruptions. But let's keep in mind when you use Hawley in a mixed dentition case, teeth are coming in and out and in and out. And every time a tooth comes in and out, you're going to have to adjust it. It's going to lose its retention. So it's not going to last the whole time, you know? So the benefit of the Hawley is twofold in a mixed dentition case going from phase one to phase two. Number one, it can keep, if you do a 2 to 2 bow, it can keep the front teeth straight and any spaces closed or keeps rotations from happening. And it can also maintain any transverse dimensions that maybe you create, maybe did some expansion or something like that because it does snap over the palate. So that would be the benefit of that. It isn't really my go-to retainer for phase one. And there's all kinds of videos on phase one retention. So I mean, it used to be, but now I think there's better things that are out there. So maybe better, you know, for comprehensive. You got to keep in mind, I mean, in terms of clasps, I generally don't choose the clasp unless there's something very, very special. Or maybe if a patient came in and they're like, hey, I need a replacement retainer. Mine's kind of broken. I want it to be like this. If someone already had one, I'll usually copy their clasp design. I'll usually snap a picture of it, or if they had a picture of it, and just tell the lab to remake it like that. Because when you go switching up clasps, sometimes patients don't like it. So this type would be good for keeping front teeth straight and maintaining transverse. It's not necessarily going to keep back teeth straight, right? Because they could rotate, they could still flare out. There's a lot of things they could do. Remember, Hawleys do not control vertical issues. So if you started out, and this is where it goes to like I can't really tell you what type of retainer you use because you have to look at the whole picture. First of all, I really love the idea of doing a retainer menu, and you're going to see that posted next week and you're going to get the why behind that. I like the idea of giving your patient one set of the recommended retainers, whatever you think is best for them, depending on where they started. And again, if you go through my retainer playlist, you'll get all the pros and cons to every type of retainer for every type of case. If they do select Hawley, then you need to think about where they started, right? If they started with vertical issues, meaning that maybe they had extruded incisors or one incisor was longer than the other, well, Hawley's probably not a great choice because it's not going to retain that. The only thing Hawley is going to do is retain the ins and outs, okay? The rotations, okay? And buccal lingual, right? And then because it doesn't cover the tops of the teeth. So teeth can still relapse in the vertical direction. One can go in, one can intrude, one can extrude. It's not going to control that. And Essex is better for that because it's going to cover the tops of the teeth and it covers the teeth in all the different dimensions. The problem with Essex is that, first of all, in order to work, they have to be made properly with proper equipment. Just using a vacuum former is not proper. It's not going to be done right and it's not going to retain right and it's going to wear out or warp. It could even move teeth in the wrong directions if it's not made properly. Also, you need multiple Essex retainers in a lifetime. They pretty much need to be on a regular subscription plan, you know, or at least have a way that they can trade them out if they get a hole in them, if they crack, if they break. A lot of it's, again, going to depend on how you made it. A Vivera Essex or a Vivera retainer made by Invisalign is made very, very well. But there's a reason they come in sets of four uppers. They only come in sets of four. They don't come as one because they don't. I mean, I give Align Technology kudos for that because they know if they sold just one, people would just get one. And then they'd be like, oh, this retainer's crap. You know, it fell apart. Well, they're not meant to last a lifetime. You're like 6 to 12 months max. After that, they start to become worn out, defective, stretch out, and your teeth aren't going to stay straight. So it's not that something obvious is going to happen to tell you to replace them. You need to replace them on a regular frequency. And that's the part where most dentists get it wrong. They just give one set and there's nothing wrong. You shouldn't be giving your patients retainers for a lifetime. There's a reason why they have subscription models for Essex. You know, 20, 30 years ago, all they gave for retention, well, 50, 40 years ago, all they gave was positioners. And those things last forever. They're great. And by the way, that's still a very viable option. I've got content made on those. I love those retainers. That's what my husband had. He had a black positioner. It looked like a giant mouth guard. It's a one-piece giant football mouth guard. Works great. I mean, he doesn't have it anymore. I did happen to see it flying around the house at one point when I was cleaning up. Wish I saved it. But yeah, that's what he got. When I had my braces in, I don't know, it was the late 80s or early 90s. Yeah, we got Hawley's on the top. They gave us a really ugly bonded on the bottom, which I had ripped off. And then, of course, I relapsed. But they last forever. Even my one from 20 years ago, I still have. 25 years ago? It's old. I still have it. It's great. You know, maybe it's a little discolored, but it still works. I never, ever had to adjust it. Never. Not one time. So great for, like I said, not great for vertical, but great for ins and outs. That's the main thing, and keeping spaces closed. You can tighten these U-loops, you know, if needed, you know, to clamp down on a space. If it stretches out a little bit, you shouldn't really need to. This is a modification. This is called a spring. It's a little, you can see it has a little helice and a helice. I don't love them this way. There's better types of spring retainers, but, you know, if you wanted to try to kick a tooth forward, you could theoretically make a modification. Like I said, I let the labs pick the clasp. I usually sand my labs lip. Once I say, I just decide what type of Hawley. It's going to be a Hawley. It's going to be a 2-2 bow, a 3-3 bow, or a circumferential, which is like this. Okay, these are circumferential retainers. Okay, so in circumferential retainers can be made without these guide wires. The benefit of the guide wire is it keeps the wire from bouncing up and down. The one I have, I purposely put no guide wire, so it only goes around the back, around my sevens. There's nothing that goes over the occlusal table. I just didn't like the way it felt, so I cut mine off. So, but also, when every time I put it on, I have to move the bow up and down. You know, I have to actually center the bow, but I know what I'm doing, right? But I just like to be able to bite down. I don't like anything blocking me from biting down. It bothers me. And it can cause weird things to happen with your bite, right? But most commonly, it does come with a guide wire. I like what they did to this circumferential retainer, also called a wraparound retainer is another word for it. I like that they put the acrylic on the labial bow like this. That is super, super smart. The benefit of the acrylic on the labial bow is it really, really helps to keep teeth straight. Okay. So it's like almost like an aligner, but again, not vertical, ins and outs. That's it. Okay. So you have to think of where your patient started. If it was crowding or spacing, spacing is really great for circumferential retainers. Like if it was a 4x exo case or it started out as spacing, it just does the best to keep spacing closed. You never want to have a wire that goes over the occlusal plane, be it a guide wire or a clasp, in any place where there was an extraction space. So for example, on a case like this, or a case like this, or a case like this, if this was a 4x exo case, you wouldn't want this design. You'd want this design because this is not good because you're having wires between where the fours were, where the fives were. And that will actually, the teeth have memory and the ligaments have memory, right? And if there's something that's always resting there, it's going to cause it to drift apart and it's not going to be able to keep it together. So extraction cases should never have a regular 3-3 or 2-2 Hawley. They should always have a wrap. Like this, always, always, or spacing cases. So this is for spacing cases. This is for anterior crowding cases. So now you get the difference, right? This would be for a case that started off with maybe an anterior diastema, not spacing in the back, but you know, and you really want to make sure that anterior diastema stayed closed. I mean, personally, I would do a bonded retainer, but that's what this little extra guide wires here is for. So Hawleys can be super modified. That's the best part about them. Depending on where we start, we can put pontics in them. We can have no clasp in a certain place. We can have extra clasp in a certain place. But if you're not sure, you can always let the lab pick the best clasp. Usually they're pretty good without that. They're going to look at the height of contour of the tooth and which teeth are missing, and they're going to pick a pretty wise choice, especially once you have a good lab. So basically, that is Hawley design in a nutshell. You get the idea. I love that you can customize them. You can make them your own. When my retainer menu comes out, you're going to get some of the verbiage that I used to use in helping patients, just to make sure, because patients can give them a little nuts with Hawleys, you know, with designs and colors and glitters, and it really can boost the price up. I used to offer a color at no charge and a glitter at no charge, okay? This is rainbow. That's design, okay? Design. This would be free. This would be free. This would probably be free. I mean, I don't mind having but you have to be very specific, and sometimes you want to have your patient draw it out for you. But certainly if there's artworks, decals, any type of major, more than one color in it, this would be more than one color, right? Because we've got two colors. It's like a fade. It's similar to nail design. They get really creative. They're really, really cool. Some are very, very cool, but it really jacks the price up. So you, customization should always be extra. And always they pay up front, you know, before it's even sent out. If they want customization, they want their initials, they want their team colors, anything like that. And I mean, usually most labs will do whatever. They don't worry about copyright because nobody's going to see what's in your mouth. But, you know, some labs might be stricter about copyright. Usually the more mom, pa, local labs, they don't care. They'll do team logos, team colors. I mean, they get real creative, but, you know. You can ask from any lab that does Hawleys. You can ask them for a copy of their artwork, their colors and their artwork. And usually they have a super cool catalog of all the stuff you can do. It is, you know, especially for a younger patient and even for an older patient. I mean, the problem is these are, when you lose them, you know, if they fall out in your bed, they're hard to find, but these are easy to find. Glow in the dark is always smart, because if you lose them and they fall out in the bed, you just, you know, turn the light on for a little while and then turn it off and boom, you know, it pops up, or black light or something like that. Always easy to find. All right. Hopefully that was helpful and it gave you some inspiration, a little bit more about how to have fun with your Hawley retainers. Great way to retain patients. Let them own the retainer process. Usually they're super happy when they go home. But I never ever force a patient to have a Hawley retainer. If they don't want one, we're going to do something else, because they're not going to be happy. Just remember that if you do Essics, they need to have a plan. They need to realize they need to have a plan to replace it on a regular basis. So if you don't already have a subscription model, there are subscription models you can outsource to where you get a small commission. I'm not going to name any of the companies because you can Google them, that will work with the doctor. Obviously, you don't want a DTC retainer subscription program. You want one that works directly with the doctor, where they're going to collect an annual fee, and they're going to store the STL of the retainer, you know, the STL, the digital file of the final STL in their server. And then the patient just comes to them if they need replacements, and you get a small commission off of it. So, but you could totally do this yourself too. You could 100% do this yourself. And I think it's only a matter of time before a lot more local labs create their own retainer subscription programs, you know, and let doctors opt into it. But yeah, great way to make additional revenue, even when the case is done, having a subscription program, and also a great way to, you know, build value to your practice. Because certainly if I was looking to buy a practice and they had a subscription model for retention that was pretty robust and money was coming in regularly, sure, that sounds like a good thing I want to buy. So it's a brilliant idea, you know? But yeah, Hawley shouldn't need to be replaced unless somebody runs over them or steps on them. There's a really great book out there. I think it's called like I Broke My Retainer. You can find it sometimes on Amazon. I don't think they print it anymore, but so funny, some of the stories. I don't think it's quite as much as it, you know, now than it used to be with the clear ones, but some of the stories I used to get about things that happened to retainers were absolutely hilarious. I mean, running over them. I know I told the story about one of my best friends in junior high that threw hers at lunchtime in the dumpster, and it was just so expensive that the mom made her come and jump in the dumpster and go look for it. I was like, oh, that sounds awful. I would never do that. But, you know, I mean, nobody wants to pay a couple $500, you know, for a new retainer if they don't have to. All right. Hope that was helpful. Thank you.